on behalf of the Servants of India Society, I wish to extend our most reverential welcome to Rajaji, who has agreed to preside on this occasion. We also extend our most sincere welcome to Mr. Palkhivala, who has agreed to address this meeting today on proposed constitutional amendments and the common man. And lastly, to all ladies and gentlemen, I extend a most sincere welcome for having responded to our invitation. Thank you.
To be in Madras, which I regard as one of the most intellectual cities of this vast subcontinent. But today, I feel particularly happy and honored that no less a person than Rajaji should chair this meeting. It is normally customary for the chairman of the meeting to say a few words about the speaker, but I think this is an appropriate occasion when the speaker should say a few words about the chairman. I have held the view, which I have expressed in public, that beyond question to my mind, Rajaji is the greatest living man today, not only in India, but in fact, if you look dispassionately and objectively in any part of the world. There are men who have distinguished themselves in the field of action, others in the field of thought. I do not recall to memory any man in world history who at Rajaji's age has been carrying on a struggle on that plane of dedicated public service which has characterized his career for so many decades. And I think this city will always remain hallowed by the presence of this one great man in your midst. And when history of India comes to be written, one of the great ifs of history will be what the destiny of this country would have been if this great spirit had been in charge of our affairs for the last 25 years. I say all this because it has a direct relevance to the subject of the talk, which is the Constitution and the common man. What is this Constitution of which we hear so much in the newspapers and which so many people seem so keen to change? You will kindly recall, those of you who are students of constitutional law, that under the Constitution, if you want to be a member of Parliament, you have to take an oath that you will uphold, protect, and preserve the Constitution. But you are not called upon to take an oath that you have read or will ever read the Constitution. The net result is that many people, innumerable in reality, who talk of changing the Constitution do not know what subject they are talking about. If you asked, and I'm willing to take the consequences of being guilty of contempt of Parliament, if you ask members of Parliament, kindly enumerate what are the fundamental rights and what their content and ambit is, I wonder how many would pass the test. Now, this is not to cast aspersions on any individual who today may be the elected representative of the people. This is merely to make good my point, which is that unfortunately we have so much ignorance about our own constitution that it is almost unbelievable. A great cynic once said, that no democracy should enthrone ignorance only because there is so much of it. And I'm afraid in our country we are so used to enthroning ignorance because there are masses and masses of it that we have almost now reconciled ourselves to being talked to by individuals who are not well acquainted and well informed about the subject matter discussed. And this is more true of fundamental rights than of anything else. Let me first tell you what is the philosophy underlying the fundamental rights, so that when you talk of changing them, abridging them, permitting the parliament for the time being in session to tinker with them, you should know the consequences of what you are bargaining for. If you look back on history, when memory holds back the door and you look back down the corridors of time, say for the last 5,000 years, the story of man goes back that far, you realize that amidst all the fluxes and changes to which the human being has always been subject, amidst all the changes and chances of destinies, empires coming and going, one factor and one factor only has always remained constant, and that is this: that at any given date in human history, you will invariably find that the majority of human beings living at that age have not known basic freedoms. Take any date in history. Take our own year, 1971. The total world population is 3,500 million. The majority of men, more than 2,000 million, do not know the basic freedoms that we know today. 2,000 million today live in conditions where a man cannot get on the stage and start talking to you as I am doing today, unless he has a taste for imprisonment. Now, this is the condition of men. The whole of South America, practically the whole of Africa, the whole of Russia, China, Indonesia, Pakistan, Burma, and a large number of other countries. Majority of men live in these conditions of regimentation, authoritarian rule, where the basic human freedoms are not known. Now, this is the basic justification for fundamental rights. Fundamental rights exist, and lucky is the nation which enjoys them, in order that the man in power for the time being may not interfere with the dignity of the individual, the basic freedom of the human being, which is more important than bread. You can have both. Do not make the mistake of thinking that one excludes the other. Do not make the mistake of thinking that so long as you enjoy your freedoms, your poverty cannot be eradicated, that bread and houses cannot be made available for the poor. If today they are not made available, it is not the fault of the Constitution, it is the fault of the policies which are being pursued. Now, the philosophy of the fundamental rights was very beautifully summed up by one of the greatest judges of all times, Justice Frankfurter. He, speaking to a university audience, once said that the justification for basic human rights, the Bill of Rights, as it is called in the United States, was this. I'm quoting his words. Man, being what he is, cannot be trusted with unlimited power when he deals with other people's rights. There are all kinds of men in public affairs, and the safety of the citizen lies not in their forbearance, but in limitations on their power. At least this is the conviction underlying our Constitution. Justice Jackson, another great legal luminary, said that the great purposes of the Constitution do not depend upon the approval or convenience of those they restrain. Undoubtedly, when small people are in charge of big nations, they find it a little irksome to be told that the fundamental law of the country prohibits them from doing certain things. Winston Churchill could lead a whole nation to victory. could make England face the greatest crisis of our life without abridging the human rights to any larger extent than what is permitted under our constitution. He could face an emergency, lead a whole nation to victory, and provide for a contingency which had never been faced before by England or any other country. This was the tremendous peril, and yet without tinkering with the people's basic rights. It needs a man of stature to be able to tackle a situation. And every language has the proverb about the bed carpenter quarreling with his tools. The constitutional law, therefore, of this country, as of France, of Germany, of the United States, of Canada, and of all freedom-loving countries, is based on the conviction that the security and the safety of the citizen lies not in the forbearance of your parliament for the time being in session, but in limitations on their power. Now, starting with this philosophy, you have, during the last 200 years only, a definite move towards preserving, protecting basic human freedoms. People talk of socialism and communism as the new theories which are today the new up-to-date theories to replace and repeal the outdated, outmoded basic rights that we enjoy. The truth of the matter is exactly the contrary. If you study history, if you read even a very popular, extremely readable story of man like the story of civilization in 10 volumes by Will Durant, you notice that socialism is at least 3,000 years old. This kind of regimentation by the state, trading by the state, business by the state, curbing the individual, telling him you will not do this, he will not do that, has been known in Sumeria in about 1200 BC, which is more than 3,000 years ago. It has been known in Peru for two centuries at least, till the conquest of Peru came in the 16th century. And it has been known in the Middle East and various other countries of the world. Regimentation by the state is a known old method of government. Basic human rights is the novel, the modern way in which people decide to govern themselves. And the basic human freedoms have been known only for the last 200 or 300 years as a matter of constitutional law. There have been some democracies like the Greek democracy, which have been pockets of democracy in the old times. But I'm talking of a basic large movement on a massive scale. This has been known only for the last 200 years. Therefore, if there is anything to choose between state regimentation and freedom, and if you have to call one modern and the other outdated, it is the basic freedom of the individual, which is the modern theory, as against state regimentation, which has been the outdated theory practiced for last many centuries. But like many other doctrines, the truth is really distorted here. I've always been feeling that for a nation whose motto is truth shall prevail, we do admirably well in the way of swallowing and propagating falsehoods. There are hardly sufficient number of individuals, I am sorry to say, in this country, who are prepared to make their voice heard in support of what they believe to be the true and the righteous cause. We are so overwhelmed by this propagation of falsehood all the time and all round that many people give up hope of ever this country turning the corner. Others think, well, what does it matter? What does an individual effort count? Well, this is the very negation of our Hindu philosophy, of the culture of this nation, which has always taught that the first duty of a man is to do what he thinks is right, irrespective of the fruits, the consequences of his own labors. And ultimately, the fruits, I have no doubt, always come. As someone beautifully said, God pays, but he does not pay every Saturday. You wait for payment, it does come, though it may not come today, Saturday. Now, this philosophy underlying the basic fundamental rights appealed to our constitution makers. Our constitution makers who worked out this constitution at the time when Rajaji was the governor general, they were handpicked men. They were not people who had to look to the electorate for votes. They did not have to rely on politics to give them bread and butter. To them, public life was a sacrifice. There were people who assumed public office, who did public duties, because elsewhere they could make much more money if they were so inclined. It was a monetary sacrifice. It was a sacrifice of their personal comforts. Socialism at that time was in the reverse. When you first practiced socialism, and you didn't talk about it. People don't talk about love for their own mother. You talk about things which you don't practice, not things which are nearest and dearest to your heart. So you will find a man like Rajaji in the year 1971 practicing what to my mind is the highest degree of socialism in his private life, his personal life, the dedicated work he is doing, and yet he is the no-changer, the man who is a conservative, the man who is not one in tune with the times. Well, we all use words which mean different things to different men. André Morvan, in his autobiography, which is entitled Call No Man Happy, has a beautiful passage where he says that to children, words do not have a very clear-cut, precise connotation. And he goes on to say, many adults go through life with this mental equipment of children. So many of us are blinded or are completely oblivious, blinded by wrong ideology being propagated, are quite oblivious of what really words should mean and ought to mean. The conviction, if I may come back to our fundamental rights, underlying our constitution is that since there are all kinds of men in public affairs, none of whom can be trusted with absolute power when he deals with other people's rights, there should be limitations on their power. So what have we provided in our constitution? No one is above the law. The President of India can be impeached. Any Supreme Court judge, High Court judge can be impeached. Any minister will work subject to limitations. The legislatures will work subject to limitations. There is no sovereignty. There is no absolute power known to anyone in India, to any institution under our constitution. This is what one judge rightly called our sublime constitution. And when you hear this ill-informed talk about constitution standing in the way of the nation's progress, you realize that we are so used to talking exactly the contrary of the truth that when the truth is expressed in public, it is almost startling. The startling truth is that the Constitution has never stood in the way of the nation's progress. And if today you are free to come to this hall, and Rajaji and I are free to be in front of you, it is because of our basic fundamental rights. Make no mistake. 15,000 people are today languishing in jail in the most progressive country of South America, Brazil, without a trial. Their only fault is that they criticize the government in power. Today in Pakistan, no newspaper dare publish the truth about Bangladesh. In Singapore, which is economically such a progressive country, no editor dare write a word against the prime minister of that state. Here we enjoy the basic freedoms, but may not for long, once. And when I look round, I wonder whether people realize what a heritage they have in this Part 3 of the Constitution. It is more precious than all your steel works and all your river projects and all the politicking and the ideology and the nonsense which is being talked about. It is infinitely more precious if only our people will have the right attitude and understand what they stand to lose. What are these fundamental rights? Another thing you will notice that these fundamental rights are sought to be taken away on the ground that the massive mandate of the people is in favor of taking them away. I think the finest comment on that subject was that of Rajaji in the Swarajya, where he said, talking of the massive mandate, he with his knowledge of history rightly pointed out that many wrong decisions, unjust decisions, hopelessly inequitable decisions have been made by an overwhelming majority of men. When Socrates was administered the hemlock, the massive majority of the Greeks supported, as Rajaji pointed out, that particular proposal. When Christ was crucified, the majority of men said, yes, the man deserves to die on the cross. When sati was being administered in India, I'm sure the majority of men must have approved of it, otherwise the custom would not have continued for so many centuries. And when queens were buried alive, with their sovereigns when the sovereign died in the Middle East countries, I'm sure the majority of the men must have applauded that custom is the right one. Now, this is because the various passions, ignorance, ferocity, hatred are many, many centuries old, which we have inherited from our animal ancestors down the centuries. Reason is a newly found toy. Man has known reason only for about 4,000 years, as against the passions and ignorance which has been the lot of men for many, many millennia before the last 4,000 years. So it will be many years and many decades and many generations before human beings are able to think clearly enough to be able to decide what is right for them. In a democracy, it is true that you must accept the verdict of the majority as laying down the law or being entitled to lay down the law. But you are not to accept that as the right decision. In other words, your duty is to say, if your mind tells you that, it is the wrong decision. If your majority of the men want it, if it becomes the law, as a good Democrat, you may struggle against it, fight against it. Ultimately, if it comes to it, after all your fight, you may permit it to be made into the law. You can't help it. But there is all the difference in the world between saying that the majority wants a thing and saying it is the right thing for the country. What I'm protesting against is to say that it is the right thing on the ground that the majority want it. Now let me come to the point, does the majority really want it? What is this majority? The total population of India is 550 million, of which 350 million are illiterate. I'm not talking of the educated illiterates. I'm talking of those who are literally illiterate. They number 350 million. They are completely unaware of the fact that there is something like Part 3 of the Constitution. They have voted at the elections. It may be right that they should vote. This is the constitutional law of our country. But when you are told that the majority have approved of the change, make no mistake, the majority is completely oblivious of any such proposal as amendment of the fundamental rights or any such existing fact as Part 3 of the Constitution. It is like my going to a village and finding an old 14th century bronze statue which some villager has dug up and my telling him, will you part with it for 10 rupees? He says, yes, thank you very much. He thinks it's a large sum. I give him 10 rupees and take that 500-year-old bronze statue. I can't say that the man has voluntarily given me the statue for 10 rupees. I am misrepresenting the facts. I am not telling you that this poor villager never knew what he was parting with. And this is the condition of the Indian electorate today. Let me tell you now the history of these fundamental rights. Ever since people fought for freedom in this country, they have been conceiving, the leaders have been conceiving of a constitution. For them it was a dream. They never knew that in the lifetime of some of them, the dream would come true. When they dreamt of a future constitution, many of them thought of permanent, inalienable, basic rights which no government could take away. Lokmanya Tilak drew up his Swarajya Bill in 1895, and he referred there to a future constitution of a free India. To him, again, it was just a dream. But he said, I dream of a time when my country will be free and there shall be a constitution where there shall be inalienable rights to freedom of speech and expression. Property is one of the things he mentions. Inviolability of one's home is the third thing that he mentions as the subject matter of an inalienable right. Then came Mrs. Annie Besant's Commonwealth of India Bill, which she modeled upon the constitution of the Irish Free State. And she borrowed the fundamental rights, which are also there in the Irish Free State Constitution. She intended them to be permanent. Then came the Congress resolution in Madras in 1926. This Congress resolution in 1926 passed in Madras expressly refers to permanent rights which a future constitution of India should aim at embodying in the fundamental law of the country. Then came the Motilal Nehru Committee of 1927, which uses the words, and I'm quoting the exact words of the Motilal Nehru Committee's report, the future constitution of India must have some rights which cannot be withdrawn in any circumstances. This is 1927. Then came Sir Tej Bahadur Sapru Committee of 1943. It was what is called the Committee of Intellectuals. In those days, the word intellectual meant something different from what it means today. Today, the word intellectual means a man who is intelligent enough to know on which side his bread is buttered. We have devalued many things, including words of the English language. Now, those intellectuals met together, they came to this consensus. They said, India is one country which has perhaps the largest and the widest diversities ever known to any nation. I don't think there is a nation which has as many diversities as we have, of language, of color, of creed, of religion, of culture, and so forth. So there are minorities in this country, not only religious minorities, but linguistic minorities, economic minorities, intellectual minorities, all kinds of minorities. In other words, various groups, various shades of opinion, all of them have to be ruled fairly and justly by one single central government in some matters and by the state government in other matters. And the Tej Bahadur Sapru Committee of 1943 said that the only way in which justice can be done to the Indian nation at large is by having some basic inalienable rights. It used the word inalienable. Then came the framing of the Constitution. Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru himself was the chairman of the committee in charge of the fundamental rights. He was the one who had a hand in drafting the report which was presented to the Constituent Assembly. And there, the words used are, these fundamental rights are intended not merely to provide for the exigencies of the moment, but to be permanent in our Constitution. The word permanent is that of this committee, headed by Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru. Then there were the committees in charge of minorities and their rights. Well, that committee in charge of minorities refused to submit its report to the Constituent Assembly till it had first seen the report of the committee in charge of fundamental rights. Having seen the fundamental rights, the committee in charge of minorities said, we have no apprehension. I think the nation will be justly and fairly governed having regard to these basic rights. So we had this constitution. And we had these basic rights. And the people of those days who framed them were the people who believed of socialism in the true sense. In the true sense, socialism means making the human and material resources of the country work in such a way that you keep the country in the mainstream of self-generating growth, that by the labors of the citizens, this country may be enriched, that by the toil and the enterprise of our own citizens, one day we may eradicate poverty, wealth may be created, and the fruits of the labors may be shared by all. This kind of socialism requires character and knowledge of the highest order. This is not socialism on the cheap. It is not socialism which consists in saying one thing, preaching one thing, doing another, living the life of good comfort and luxury, and telling everybody else that you must tighten your belt. This socialism was the socialism founded on knowledge, on character, on integrity. And if you look at the speeches made in the Constituent Assembly and the moral tone, you would be just amazed. You would not believe that you are living in the same country in just with a lapse of only 24 years. Believe me. I had occasion to check up those debates, and frankly, I couldn't believe that I am living in the same country in which these things were said in the Constituent Assembly. Now, the question is, have we reached a stage in our country's history when basic fundamental rights should be allowed to be abridged by Parliament? The first thing to note is, what are these rights? Normally, even when I was talking the other day to the National Defense College in Delhi, I noticed it consisted of the elite. But I noticed that most people just thought that the right they were concerned with was the right to property. The right to property is only one of a large number of basic human rights which the constitution makers had the foresight to provide for you. Frankly, if you'll pardon my saying so, for an ungrateful nation. Because if people will not show their gratitude for by fighting for what is given to them, I don't know who can save them. No one can save a nation, not the judiciary. The only one which can save the nation is the citizen himself. It is his exertion, his effort, his mobilization of public opinion which can make your fundamental rights remain on the statute book. What are these rights? The right to equality before the law. The right to personal liberty. You cannot be arrested and put in prison without a trial unless you come under the Preventive Detention Act, where again certain stringent provisions are there for safeguarding even that citizen's liberty, which citizens, to my mind, doesn't frankly deserve to be a free citizen over free democracy. But even for him, we go out of our way to see that some safeguards are given. The right to equality of opportunity in government service. Do you realize how important this right is and how progressive we are compared to even a nation like England? In England, which is the home of democracy, which is one of the most progressive nations on earth, and where freedom is so cherished and prized and equality is treasured by the people. Do you know that even their finest lawyer cannot become the Lord Chancellor if he is a Roman Catholic? In England, you can't. In other words, it's like saying that a non-Hindu cannot become the Chief Justice of India. Under our constitution, he can, and he has a legal right to be that. In England, no. Imagine to what extent our thinkers who gave us this great treasure, how far advanced they were in their thinking, what their vision was. They were the truly secular people. Their secularism consisted not in getting the votes of one community by representing certain ideologies. No, their secularism consisted in giving that type of constitution to the people where everybody in reality will have the same treatment. And mind you, it is really not a secular state but a non-denominational state. Secular means which recognizes no religion. We are a non-denominational state. Every religion is recognized. Every religion can be propagated. This, to my mind, is a very, very basic, important human freedom. The right to practice your religion, propagate it, and keep all the culture intact by all the means at your command. So the right of religious practice, freedom of religious practice, the right to equality, the right to practice any profession, the right to carry on business. Why did our constitutions give this fundamental right to carry on business? Because they knew that it is only by the exertions of the individual, the honest individual, and the individual who in the process of creating wealth will create wealth not only for himself but for people all around. As Mr. B.K. Nehru, now the governor of Assam, said in a brilliant speech the other day to the Assam University, he said, the days are gone when wealth could be created by one man at the expense of another. Formerly, 500 years ago, suppose you wanted to do business and you wanted to monopolize, what you did was you drove away the other traders who were in that area and you took the trade all in your own hands. Or you could have a large estate all to yourself and small farmers could have no scope. But today, by the methods of technology and industrialization, if you create wealth on a big scale, it is bound to redound to the national benefit. Bound to. Because you must give employment to people, you must pay excise, you must pay income tax, and if income tax is not collected, it is the fault of the government, not of the constitution. Now, the constitution makers knew, as Dr. Erhard said in Germany, he said, I shall let the man and money loose and they will make Germany great. He was quite right. He let the man and money loose and they made Germany great. So great that the German currency now is holding its own against the American dollar, America the conqueror, and this is the vanquished nation. And the same with Japan. How do you think have Japan and Germany risen economically in a miraculous manner? Only by the labors and exertions of the people. But with a certain degree of freedom, subject, of course, always to social restraints in the public interest. Nobody is ever doubting that. Whenever a man talks of freedom in this country, you must rest assured that he is fully conscious of the fact that that freedom must be subject to reasonable restrictions in the public interest. There is no question about it. So that nobody says there should be laissez-faire, that you must be allowed to do what you like at the expense of your fellow citizens. The philosophy which is being advanced by the lovers of freedom like Rajaji is that you must give that degree of freedom to an individual where, when he is not doing any social harm, but he is doing social good, then let him at least develop the national economy, which is not being permitted to be done today. Now, The philosophy underlying the constitution was therefore that the citizens should be free to develop this economy, and that's why the fundamental right to carry on business. The other rights, the right to form associations, the right to form unions, and most important of all, the right of freedom of speech and expression. This is a priceless right. We have enjoyed it. We did not enjoy it prior to 1947. You could go to jail before 47, as some of the distinguished citizens in this hall must have, for saying things which were not quite palatable to the authorities for the time, for that at that time in power. Now, such a thing cannot happen here under our basic human freedom as it is today enshrined in the Constitution. These are the wide rights. They cover the whole spectrum of human rights. These rights are so precious. Let me give you one example only, how vital and how significant they are. Up to last century, whenever the cause of freedom was espoused, it was espoused by great thinkers like Voltaire, Rousseau, Milton, Tom Paine, who would fight for individual freedom or nation's freedom. But in our century, for the first time, whole nations are, as nations, espousing the cause of basic human freedoms. And in the United Nations, they drew up a charter called the Charter of Basic Human Rights. They are called political and civil rights. Those are the rights which, according to the United Nations, must be guaranteed to every nation. And mind you, our fundamental rights chapter only corresponds to that, the basic civil and political rights. What the United Nations thinks should be given to every nation is what we have been given under our constitution. And talking of the right to property, there is no democracy on earth which has a more restricted right to property than we have today. Our right is already quite restricted. It is subject to all reasonable restrictions in the public interest, number one. Number two, anybody's property can be taken away for a public purpose. Three, if compensation is paid, it must not be a mockery of the legal concept of compensation, but even if it is inadequate, the court cannot interfere. But it must not amount to a rejection of the legal concept of compensation. And fourthly, if agrarian reform is aimed at, if zamindaris, large rural holdings are to be abolished, there is no fundamental right to property at all. Now, these are the limits within which we today have the right to property. What more can be done? What more can be done by way of abridging, curtailing that right further? Now, if this is the situation already existing, do you think there is a justification for the parliament, for the time being in power, elected for a 5-year term, to take away these rights further, to abridge them, and mind you, abridge any one of these rights? This is the proposal. What is this 24th amendment of the constitution, which has already been passed by parliament and is being ratified by one state legislature after another? When the state legislatures ratify and politicians pass this, I am reminded of the old words of the Bible, God forgive them, they do not know what they are doing. If I want to argue one single case on a point arising under the Constitution of India, I must have a 3-year intensive training in law, I must pass an examination, I must be enrolled, I must have a certificate as to my integrity and character before I am enrolled, and then I am allowed to argue one case, any one case, if I want to, under the Constitution. But if I want to change the Constitution, and I want to say wholesale, I must be given the right to take away the fundamental right. I need no training, no knowledge, no skill, no examination, nothing. The price that democracy pays is that very often and more often than not, it throws mediocrity into power. It is seldom that you will have an Abraham Lincoln or a Rajaji elected. More often than not, considerations will weigh with the electorate, which frankly frighten one when you look at the reality of the way in which democracy in practice works. See, if you were to be told, well, let a Marcus Aurelius deal with your fundamental rights, well, I would say thank you very much, I have no hesitation, let him do what he pleases. But you have to ask yourself how many of your elected representatives fall in that category. And how many are people who have even taken the trouble to acquaint themselves with what they are dealing with and the subject matter which is before them. I remember one member of parliament telling me of his own experience. He came out of parliament and it was the Tariff Act amendment which was being discussed. And I was outside talking to somebody and I knew this member was interested in tariff regulations. I said, why are you outside? Aren't you inside? He says, no, they are discussing some traffic bill. It happens all over the world. You must have seen pictures of even the President of the United States, Johnson, when he was seeking election. He had to go out with a donkey, an elephant, balloons, etc. It makes you sometimes think what must be the level of the average human mind. But now you must realize all that when you consider the proposal that your elected representatives should have freedom to deal with your fundamental rights. Only in that limited context I am making this criticism of the unavoidable processes of an adult franchise working in reality. This is how it works. Now, just consider the anomaly this way and see if to your logical mind it makes any sense. Suppose you elect a parliament for 5 years as you have the last one. If that parliament, by a unanimous vote of every single member present and voting, and assume that every single member of parliament is in the house, which never happens, but assume that, and assume that everyone unanimously votes that a certain law should be passed, and if that law violates even one fundamental right, the court will strike it down. But if not by a unanimous vote, but by the requisite two-thirds majority, they want to scrap the whole Part 3 of the Constitution, all the fundamental rights, nobody can say that Parliament has done an invalid thing. Does it make any sense to you that the same individuals who are not permitted by a unanimous vote to abridge one single fundamental right, to violate a single fundamental right, should have the freedom to take away any or all of the fundamental rights? This is what the 24th Amendment has done. It has been passed by Parliament. It has been in great haste ratified by one state legislature after another. What is this 24th Amendment? And kindly consider the implications. First, Parliament has been given the right by the 24th Amendment to take away, abridge any fundamental right, not only the right to property, but any of them, even the right to freedom of speech and expression, even the right to personal liberty, even the right to form associations, the right to equality before the law, to propagate your religion according to your lights. Number two, once these fundamental rights are amended, not only Parliament, but every state legislature and every executive, either at the center or in the states, is free to act as it likes without the fetter of the fundamental right, which is now no longer in operation. So you have, by this, you are giving the power not only to Parliament, but to every state legislature, and not only to the central government, but to every executive of every state, to regulate the affairs of this country in disregard of any fundamental right which may come to be abridged hereafter. So suppose Parliament were to abridge the right to freedom of speech and expression, then a law can be passed in India saying anyone who criticizes the government in power shall be guilty of a crime punishable with 1 year's imprisonment. It can be passed and there is no redress. No one can challenge the law. Today such a law cannot be passed. After this amendment, it can be, once the right to freedom of speech and expression is abridged by Parliament, as it can do after the 24th Amendment. Consider the other significance. One of the fundamental rights is the right to move the Supreme Court for relief. You have a right to move the Supreme Court under Article 32 for redress of your fundamental rights. That right can be taken away by Parliament. In fact, there are some politicians who are already talking of it. They want a judiciary which must be subservient to the executive. I think you are then wasting the people's money in having such a judiciary. The better thing is not to have a judiciary and let the minister dispense justice. Whenever there is a public scandal, whenever there is any public wrong done or any public outcry, who is appointed? A High Court judge, a Supreme Court judge. This shows the respect our people have for the judiciary, and rightly. This country, believe me, and I say it in all sincerity, would not be worth living in today but for our judiciary. I don't know what would have happened. I don't know where our politicians would have taken us, but for the strong independent judiciary, which very luckily we have been enjoying so far. It is the, as Rajaji again said, if I may quote it again, whenever you speak on the Constitution, you can't help quoting Rajaji. He said, it is the last and the greatest bulwark against authoritarianism in our country, our judiciary. And I think that tribute is fully justified. Now that right to move the judiciary, Article 32 of the Constitution, being itself a fundamental right, can be abridged by Parliament at any time hereafter. In fact, the whole article can be deleted tomorrow if Parliament chooses. And you will have no right to go to the Supreme Court as you have today. Imagine a people voting for such a ridiculous outrage on the Constitution. There was a time when people went to jail to get freedom for themselves. I think we have reached a stage when people must be willing to go to jail to preserve their basic human freedoms. It is easier to throw off a foreign tyranny than the tyranny of your own elected representatives. Make no mistake. And to my mind, a law does not cease to be tyrannical because it is passed by the elected representatives of the people. In fact, you have sometimes a great emperor who, as a benevolent despot, may give a better administration than elected people, elected representatives. It all depends on the caliber, the vision, the degree of integrity of the people you return to office. So in a democracy, the price which you pay for being a citizen of a democracy is eternal vigilance. If you are not prepared to have eternal vigilance, you are unfit to be the citizens of a free democracy. Because freedom is not something you can inherit in the bloodstream. It's not that your father enjoyed it, therefore my young friends here in the galleries would be able to enjoy it. No, you don't inherit in the bloodstream. You have to fight for it, cherish it, preserve it all the time. Otherwise, it just vanishes. It has already vanished this year, 1971, in the form of the 24th Amendment. But look at the extreme arrogance, and I use my word advisedly, arrogance of the people who have passed this 24th Amendment. They go on to say, once the President of India is presented with a bill abridging any of the fundamental rights, he shall have no right to say, I shall not assent to the bill. In other words, if the President of India is shown a Sugar Control Act, he can say, no, I'm sorry, I think it is ridiculous, I won't give my assent. But if he is presented with a bill which says the whole chapter on fundamental rights shall be abrogated, he must give his consent. Now, the law under our Constitution is this, under Article 211, that if the President refuses to give his assent, his only alternative is to present it again to Parliament for reconsideration. And if after reconsideration Parliament comes to the same conclusion, namely that the bill should be passed, then the President is bound to give his assent. But our politicians in their arrogance don't want the President even to ask them to reconsider a question dealing with fundamental rights. The poor President of India, all that he can do is... All that he can do is to tell the Parliament, as Cromwell told his Parliament, as you will recall, think in the bowels of Christ, you might be mistaken. Our President can't even tell the members of Parliament, you want to take away all the fundamental rights, would you like to reconsider this matter? No, he can't say that. He must give his assent immediately. I think, frankly, this is devaluing the office of the President, if ever there was a way of devaluing it. This is your 24th Amendment. Now when the 24th Amendment is passed, what you have been told is assurance in Parliament by high-ranking individuals. Please rest assured, we will not tinker with your freedoms. In connection with that assurance, kindly consider two things. The princes were given an assurance in writing, which Rajaji signed as the Governor General of India, where he said that you are guaranteed this privy purse. And your descendants who occupy the Gadi are guaranteed that. Not only the government of India's guarantee under the signature of the Governor General, we put it in the Constitution. In Article 291 we said, the privy purse free of taxes is guaranteed and shall be paid out of the Consolidated Fund of India. It is the highest guarantee, the highest assurance the greatest security known to our law. What has come to that security and assurance? The people who are alive today, who signed in 1947 this document as the other party to the covenant, they are today alive, many of them, and they will not get a pie. I'm not talking of those individuals. Those individuals are not worth saving, but the honor of India is undoubtedly worth saving. It is the honor of your country. People have laid down their lives for the honor of their country. What nonsense are we talking today about this being anachronism and the rest? What has become anachronistic is the sense of integrity, justice and fairness. That unfortunately has become anachronistic in our times today in India. Now, if the greatest guarantee known to law, enshrined in the Constitution, is of no avail, what do you make of verbal assurances given by individuals? I mean, a man must be perfectly infantile in his outlook if he believes that this assurance has any effect whatsoever. Consider secondly this. Is the assurance worth anything at all, assuming it is well intended and assuming it is really to be carried out by the elected representatives? What is this assurance? Every parliament changes every 5 years. Who knows who will be in power tomorrow? When the going is good, when the market is bullish, every speculator thinks it will go up and up. When it is down, everybody thinks it will still go down. But nature has a way of working which is very different from what we normal individuals with our limited intellects can perceive. There are ways and ways, as Emerson said, I keep and pass and turn again, when he was talking of Brahma. If the red slayer thinks he slays, or if the slain think he is slain, he knows not well the subtle ways in which I keep and pass and turn again. Now, if nature has a way of turning and turning a corner before you know where you are, you can rest assured that nothing is everlasting. No one's power is everlasting. What is the assurance as to what the next parliament would do? But in this case, it is something more grave than that. You don't have to wait for the next parliament. This very parliament has told you at the time when it passed the 24th Amendment as to what it proposes to do once it is given the power to abridge fundamental rights under the 24th Amendment. And it has told you that by introducing in parliament the 25th Amendment Bill, which tells you quite frankly, I must give full marks for frankness to this parliament. It tells you quite frankly what it proposes to do once it has been given the power to abridge fundamental rights. It is like a cashier who comes for employment to you and who tells you that he would like to operate on your bank account and at the same time tells you that he proposes to build his own house out of your bank account. What is this 25th Amendment? It is this. Let me tell you and ask you to consider whether it makes any sense to you. You may not know the law. You don't have to know the law to understand the implications of the 25th Amendment. All that you have to do is to have some experience of human affairs and some common sense which makes you understand what is good for you and what is not good for you and for your children. This Constitution is not intended only for you and for me. It is intended to give such a momentum to the living principles of the rule of law that democracy and civil liberty may survive in India beyond our own times and in the days when our place will know us no more. This is the future, the unfolding future of our great Constitution. Now, what does the 25th Amendment propose to do with it? The 25th Amendment is the amendment Parliament will pass after the 24th Amendment has become the law. In other words, after the 24th Amendment is ratified by the state legislatures. The 25th Amendment is this. First, Article 31 of the Constitution will be amended. A man's property can be taken away without payment of compensation. He has only to be paid an amount. Now, do you realize the legal implications of this? I'll tell you about the case later after I've completed what they want to do. First, your property can be taken away without payment of compensation. And property doesn't mean zamindaris, doesn't mean palaces. Your little shop, your little dispensary, your father's little workhouse, he may be repairing tires or he may be an artisan, your own little home, your own 1 acre of land, anything can be taken away without payment of compensation. All that has to be paid to you is an amount. Now, amount, as any dictionary will tell you, means a sum of money. It does not. A rupee is a sum of money, 100 rupees is a sum of money. Your property may be worth 1,000, but it can be taken away for 100 rupees. Now, the second thing is, and this again shows how completely ignorant, if you'll pardon my saying so, our lawmakers are of what they are legislating about. The second provision is even more ridiculous. It says this, that before, if your property is acquired, the fundamental right under Article 19(1)(f) will not apply. Now, what is the effect of this fundamental right under 19(1)(f) as regards property? The right is this. Suppose your property is acquired under Article 31, and under today's constitution, under Article 31, you have to be given compensation. And according to the Supreme Court's judgment in the bank nationalization case, the concurrent article which applies is Article 19(1)(f), under which there can be only reasonable restrictions on your right to hold property, and therefore, before your property is acquired, you have a right to be heard. Because if you are not heard, it is not a reasonable restriction on your right to hold property. So suppose you are a doctor and your dispensary is sought to be acquired by the government to start a ration shop. You are entitled to say, look, Mr. Minister, why do you want to take this away? I'm treating so many poor people. I'm doing more public good than your ration shop ever will. And would you let me continue my practice? You have a right to be heard. Mostly you may be heard, you may be raising your voice in vain, but never mind. You have a right to be heard and you have the satisfaction at least that you have had your say, you have expressed your point of view, and if still somebody wants to do you injustice, well, it is compounding the injustice. But after the amendment of the Constitution, proposed under the 25th Amendment, 19(1)(f) will not apply to any cases of acquisition, requisition of property by the government. So if your property is sought to be taken away, you cannot claim even the right to be heard. This is your free democracy. And this is the reason for which you took all the trouble in the beginning of this year to elect so many representatives to your parliament, for all of whom you are paying a daily allowance, housing and the rest, in order that your basic rights may be taken away. Frankly, I feel so strongly about it. And what distresses me no end is that why is the elite of this country putting up with this kind of outrage on our basic democracy? Why should a man not be heard before his property is taken away? What is wrong with it? What is the social purpose served by not even hearing him? If you look at some of the cases which come to the High Court and the Supreme Court, you would be amazed how the power of acquisition can be abused. One case which we argued before Mr. Justice Subbarao in 1964 came from Madras, where the government wanted to acquire a plot of land. And the very curious thing was that out of this whole area, certain plots belonging to certain individuals were not acquired, and the rest were all acquired. The Supreme Court struck it down on the ground that this is no real power of acquisition. It has been done in a manner not warranted by the Constitution. These are the type of cases, and this is the mischief which the Constitution sought to prevent. But hereafter, no compensation and no right to be heard. But there is another provision which is even more vicious, and that is in the same 25th Amendment, which I wish was more widely known and widely debated, and that is the Article 31C of the Constitution, which they want to introduce for the first time. This article wants to say this, and mind you, it will become the law unless people are vigilant and are prepared to sacrifice even their personal liberty for the sake of upholding their Constitution. This new provision is this. Article 31C, let me put it to you in simple language so that everybody can understand who may not be familiar with the technicalities of the Constitution. If any act of Parliament or any act of the state legislature starts with the words that this act is intended to give effect to the directive principle of the state policy under Article 39, that there should be no concentration of economic power. If these are the opening words of the act, whether passed by Parliament or the state legislature, then no fundamental right will apply. This, to my mind, is the utmost in utter contempt for the Constitution. There is no other word for it. It is the ultimate in contempt for the Constitution. What does it mean? Without abridging any of the fundamental rights, without even letting the people know that fundamental rights are gone, any law has only to be passed with these opening words, that this law is intended to give effect to the directive principle of the state policy regarding concentration of economic power. And what is the consequence? No fundamental right shall apply. So suppose you are living in a house, your own house, which your father built with his life savings, and the government wants to take it away.
And next to you is a politician who, out of means not known, not disclosed, and not ascertainable, and not identifiable by any process of reasoning or known sources, has a very fine house which is 10 times more palatial than yours. And if your house is taken away and his house is really more suitable for the purposes which the government wants your house for, your right to equality before the law doesn't apply. So you can't say, look at my neighbor's house, kindly take that, it is much more convenient. Nor can you say, why are you taking mine? What have I done, etc. No, none of the fundamental rights apply at all. Therefore, any law can be passed by parliament or by the state legislature and no fundamental right, neither to equality before the law, nothing at all. And it has only to start with the words that this is meant to give effect to the directive principle of the state policy. Now the question arises, suppose a man were to go to a court of law and say, this particular law is not intended to give effect to the directive principle of the state policy. In fact, if it is implemented, it can never promote the state policy. Well, that is taken care of by the 25th Amendment. 25th Amendment says nobody shall raise any such question in a court of law. In other words, you cannot go to a court of law and even argue that the law which is intended or purports to give effect to the, not is intended, people know what the real intentions are, but what purports to give effect to the directive principle of the state policy can never give effect to the directive principle. In fact, you may be able to prove logically and objectively that it would defeat the directive principle of the state policy, but you can't raise any such point. No court shall go into the question as to whether the law which purports to give effect to the directive principle of the state policy will in fact give effect to it or not. It's not justiciable. Well, ladies and gentlemen, if you live in a democracy where such a ridiculous proposition can be introduced in parliament amidst acclamations, and people can take it lying down without a debate in the newspapers, without people even raising their voice in protest, frankly, your basic freedoms are not worth saving. It means this, that hereafter no one is safe once this 25th Amendment is passed. And the same parliament which wants the right to take away your fundamental rights has told you, as I started by telling you, what it proposes to do is the very first step once you give it the power. And what it proposes to do is to do this for you. And this bill is already introduced in parliament. And this bill will not need any ratification by the state legislatures, because that idle ceremony will be over once for all. Of the 24th Amendment being ratified. Thereafter, Parliament can do what it likes. No ratification by any state legislature, even if the whole chapter on fundamental rights is removed. Naspai, who introduced first what has come to be known as the Naspai's Bill, after hearing evidence before the Select Committee, he himself realized the danger of giving this type of power to Parliament. So in the Select Committee, he himself introduced a safeguard that without the ratification of the states, no fundamental right can be taken away. This government has not accepted even that safeguard. And though the first bill, the 24th Amendment, will have to be ratified, thereafter any amendment of any fundamental right will need no ratification by any state legislature. Now this 31C, just consider the consequences of it. And think in times that you live, the type of regimentation you are under, the licenses, the permits, which you have to seek from the government all the time. What kind of existence would it be? What kind of opportunity for our people to create national wealth and to eradicate poverty? How on earth can you do it? This is the 25th Amendment. The 26th Amendment proposes to abolish the privy purses. Frankly, believe me, I have no affection whatsoever, and if you'll forgive my saying so, very little of respect for most of the recipients of the privy purse. But to me, as to Rajaji, it is only a matter of principle. The real question is it worthwhile dragging in the mire the good name of your country for the sake of 4.5 crores of rupees, which is a sum dwindling year after year as the Maharajas died. Now, our constitution makers were so vigilant about the integrity of India, the national honor of India, that they have a scheme in the constitution which works this way. If you have a claim for even 75 rupees against the government, state government or central government, you can get a decree against the government. Once you get a decree against the government, that decretal amount of 75 rupees becomes a charge on the Consolidated Fund of India. And no state legislature, no parliament has a right to vote on that It must be paid to you as a matter of right. It is a charge on the consolidated fund. And no parliament can say that the money will not be paid to you, because it has become a charge on the consolidated fund of India under the constitution itself. Look at the degree of integrity and the sense of national honor which the constitution makers had just 24 years ago. And the privy purse is charged on the consolidated fund of India, and today it is thought to be just abrogated. We must, every Indian must hold down his head in shame. It can happen to the Maharajas today, it can happen to you and me tomorrow. It can happen to any government servant. A government servant's salary and pension is charged on the consolidated fund of India. A High Court judge's salary and pension is charged on the consolidated fund of India. What is his security? What is the security of any individual today who puts in 30 years of service with the government and then is told after 30 years that your provident fund comes to take a general in the army? I asked a general who recently retired, what's your provident fund? All told, the retirement benefits come to 1,75,000 rupees. If the government may well say, no, in a socialist country, this is far too much. Sorry. We can't pay you that much sum of money. Please take 55,000. For the rest, take government bonds. No, under the constitution as it stands today, it has to be paid. But not after the constitution is amended and the rights are gone. A civil servant today, right is to approach the High Court and the Supreme Court. How many have approached successfully and got their honor vindicated? Hereafter, the right can be taken away, because your very right to move the court can be taken away. The situation is fraught with such tremendous dangers that I think this country must have lost all intelligence if it is going to submit to this type of amendment of the constitution in a placid, quiet manner. And make no mistake, do not think that this is an idle apprehension. Let me end with the words of Justice Salmon, a judge of the House of Lords in England, who recently delivered the Haldane Memorial Lecture before the London University as recently as the 4th December 1917, that's last year. He said in England, with his 800 years of Parliament and before the Parliament the Witan, which corresponded in the Anglo-Saxon days to the present Parliament, he said, I strongly advocate that in England we must have a Bill of Rights. Now, Bill of Rights means, as I've already told you, fundamental rights. And he gave his reasons. He says, the way governments of the world, all over the world, are now going in a certain direction, there is more and more regimentation. Less and less respect for the individual, for his dignity, his self-respect, his freedom of action. And a day may come, I'm quoting now his words, Lord Simmons, he is a sitting judge of the House of Lords in England. He says, a day may come within 30 years, he says 30 to 40 years, when it may become a criminal offense to criticize the government in power. When such a law is passed, the judge will have only two options, either to resign and not administer such a law, or to convict the man who is brought before him for criticizing the government. And he says, in order that such a day may not come, let the people give themselves a Bill of Rights. Now, if in a democracy like Britain, where freedom is bred in the bones of the people, where love of liberty is the cherished possession of every individual, if there a sitting judge of the highest judiciary thinks that fundamental rights are needed, what do you say to a democracy like ours, which has known democracy for exactly 24 years in its 5,000 years of history, 24 years, and which has got 65% illiterate? Do you think we don't need these fundamental rights? You have them already, and you have decided through your elected representatives that they can be taken away at the free will of the executive, virtually the executive for the time being in power. It is a sad year in India's history, 1971. There is still hope. The 25th Amendment is not yet passed. If we can arouse the national conscience, if we can charge the national conscience with some respect for the great minds which gave us this constitution, and some gratitude for what the freedom fighters did for us. They went to jail, they languished in jail, they spent some of their best years in jail. For what? In order that one tyranny may be substituted by another? Well, frankly, I say these things strongly because I feel very strongly. And I think unless the people of this nation are vigilant, there will be no hope left for the survival of freedom in a few years' time. I say trust nobody. I don't say merely don't trust the existing. If I were a member of parliament, don't trust me. with the right to deal with your fundamental rights. I am unfit for that job, I know it. I must not be given full power to deal with your fundamental rights, and no other citizen of this country should be given that power. Let the Constitution remain sovereign, and let the people retain their sovereignty by keeping these rights unto themselves. If that happens, then alone you will find freedom will survive. And finally, may I say this, when I entered the hall, one citizen was kind enough to give me this note. He says, how do you think, without amending the chapter on fundamental rights, can the directive principles be ever implemented? My answer is, the directive principles have a better chance of being implemented with the fundamental rights than without them. It only shows the power of words. Advertise a certain tonic widely, like Tono Bungay in H.G. Wells' novel of that name, Tono Bungay, which was really slightly injurious to health. And by selling this tonic, the manufacturer made a vast fortune. You can easily, merely by putting a certain point of view to the people, time and again and repeatedly, condition the human mind to think that, yes, a certain thing is needed. Our Indian mind is today conditioned to think that unless the fundamental rights are amended, directive principles cannot be implemented. I ask one simple question. Which scheme of economic reform, which is wisely conceived and honestly implemented, has ever been defeated by our fundamental rights? Point out to me one scheme of any state, any center, any state government or any central government. Not one. You will not find one scheme being defeated by the fundamental rights. Not one. The fundamental rights are there as the iron framework within which your salvation can be reached and you can work out your great destiny. And finally, may I say this, that our Constitution as it stands today without the amendment will ensure that this great nation can have stability without stagnation and change without the destruction of human values. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, I have come to this meeting only to give an ocular demonstration that I am still alive, even though such wrong things are deliberately planned to be done in our country. No one felt more strongly the deterioration in our character at any time than I do today. If our nation has to continue to be respected, we must find ways and means to defeat the purposes that have now been published and broadcast, namely, to do away with what we solemnly did only 24 years ago. Even then, those who sat with me at the time felt apprehensions about our people. And so they did not merely rely on Parliament, but they made what is called a constitution. A parliamentary law is different from a constitution. The Germans have a better word for the constitution. They call it basic law. But the Constitution defines the way of life for the people as well as for the government. Both have to be restrained. But what is wanted to be done today is that the government should not be restrained and that the Constitution should be broken up. The fundamental rights, which phrase has been used so often, that it has become somewhat meaningless. Let me tell you that it has a meaning. The fundamental rights are to the Constitution what the heart is to the bodily constitution. You can, when it becomes necessary, carry out an operation on the heart, but you cannot do away with the heart. The fundamental rights correspond to the heart and the lungs and the liver of the human body. Simply because doctors tell you that they can perform some minor operations and do some good to the body as a whole, you should not imagine that you can give them the right to take away the liver, or to take away the heart, or to take away the lungs. This is just what is sought to be done. I do not think I need detain you when you have heard Mr. Palkhivala explain the position as clearly as an honest man with information and experience can explain. There are very few honest men these days who stand up to such work. Unfortunately, I must acquaint my friend Palkhivala that in South India, our sense of humor sometimes overwhelms our sense of right and wrong. When you say something that is discreditable to our people, you hear cheers in our audience. Not because they approve of what is wrong, but because they are so glad that there is someone to point out where we are wrong. If therefore today I have been attending with particular care, equipped with special hearing instruments, because generally on the platform you don't hear what important speakers speak on the platform. All the rest of you hear, but those on the platform don't hear. Today I made special arrangements to hear every word of what was said. I now realize, Mr. Palkhivala, in what a dangerous situation we are in. We were not in such danger when the British were here. I make it quite clear. In 1937, when the British were here, I had charge of the government of Madras, as it was then called, which included large parts of Kerala, Mysore, Andhra, and all that. I think I then gave to the people a socialist government, which Mrs. Indira Gandhi is not going to give to the people. That was when the British were here. Because I had a sense of justice, and the British, when a man was doing what was just, did not interfere with him. That was their way of life. Now today, I realize that we are in a very dangerous state. Much more dangerous. There is much more reason to oppose the constitutional changes that are now proposed than there was reason to oppose the government of India by Parliament in England. There was good reason to oppose foreign rule, but on the merits, there was less reason then for us to object to foreign rule than we have today to object to indigenous Swadeshi rule by Mrs. Indira Gandhi and her company. Don't be afraid to clap. If you wish to clap, please clap. I want to tell you that there has been great moral deterioration among our people, so much so that if I say Mrs. Indira Gandhi is doing harm to the country, although every single individual in this hall and upstairs agrees with me, is afraid something may happen to him if he says something against Mrs. Indira Gandhi. Is that democracy? It is a state of utter timidity of which, gentlemen, I am ashamed at the age of 93 to speak about. Why should we be afraid of anybody on earth? Surely you are not going away to utter destruction because somebody does something. You are a permanent immortal soul. Don't be afraid of anybody. If I impressed on you the single truth, I should be content. Don't be afraid of anybody on earth. Provided you are right, provided you are in the right, you need not be afraid of anybody. Therefore, live courageously. And what is the demonstration that is expected of you today in this connection? If these constitutional amendments are passed, every young man who deserves to be born in this country and to live after Gandhi and after all the other fellow colleagues of Gandhiji fought and obtained freedom, every man here should fight these constitutional changes to the best of his ability. And as to how it should be fought, you must pray to God to give you a proper leader to direct you. I must ask you most earnestly to thank Mr. Palkhivala to have come all the way to give us his explanation of the entire situation. Mr. Palkhivala is not a demagogue. He is a lawyer by training, and by practice he has learned to restrain his language. He has spoken the truth and with great restraint. But the situation is so dangerous that what he has said must be taken to heart much more seriously than when an appeal was made to people of this country for freedom. Many of you were born after the non-cooperation movement. At any rate, many of you became understanding young men. Most of you became understanding young men only after the non-cooperation movement was started and succeeded. Therefore, I must tell you what I am telling you, namely, that today we are in a graver situation than we ever were under the Mughals or under any previous government. Let me tell you that the Mughals had no constitution. We had no constitution when the Mughals ruled us, but they ruled us well. We have a constitution today. They want to abolish that constitution. I only ask you young men to take this book. It's a small book of 300 and odd articles. Read the preamble only. You needn't go further. Read the preamble and see whether you think it is right to take away the lifeblood of this constitution, the heart, as I called it, of the constitution. Further talking on my part is unnecessary. As I told you, let us thank Mr. Palkhivala. Now, Mr. Palkhivala has very probably to plead with the Supreme Court in the same manner as he has done now with you. Let us hope that whatever may be the quality of the Supreme Court judges who are now appointed, as soon as they join the court, they will rise to their full stature. There is something in an institution. I hope they will maintain and defend, protect the honor of that institution, which the Constitution has placed above Parliament in order to interpret the laws of the country and the Constitution. Thank you very much. Whenever even smaller men come to speak to you, then, Mr. Palkhivala, if it is announced that it is an important subject, you should all attend. It's no use your attending when Palkhivala comes to speak to you. You should hereafter keep up an agitation against these dangers that are before us.